Good evening, everyone. This afternoon, we have assembled here to give God thanks for the life of Annelda, Yoretta, Gooding-Payne. On behalf of my family, I want to extend condolences and sympathies to her husband and her children. And we want to welcome you and thank you for being here with us this afternoon as we reflect on her life and reflect on the type of person she was. If you look in your, I don't want to call them gift bags, but if you look in your little bag, you'll see a program, and that is what we'll follow. The program will follow as is, which means that I will not be announcing, you will just come when you see your name slot to come. So let us stand and we will sing the first song in our program, which was a favorite of Aunt Nell. There shall be showers of blessing. There shall be showers of blessing. This is the promise of love. There shall be seasons refreshing, sent from the Savior above. Showers of blessing. Showers of blessing we need. Mercy drops round us are falling, but for the showers we plead. There shall be showers of blessing, precious reviving again. Over the hills and the valleys, sounds of abundance of rain. Showers of blessing, showers of blessing we need. Mercy drops round us are falling, but for the showers we plead. There shall be showers of blessing, send them upon us, O Lord. Grant to us now a refreshing, come and now honor thy word. Showers of blessing we need. Mercy drops round us are falling, but for the showers we plead. There shall be showers of blessing, oh, that today they might fall. Now as to God we're confessing, now as on Jesus we call. Showers of blessing, showers of blessing we need. Mercy drops round us are falling, but for the showers we plead. There shall be showers of blessing, if we but trust and obey. There shall be seasons refreshing, if we let God have his way. Showers of blessing, showers of blessing we need. Mercy drops round us are falling, but for the showers we plead. Let us bow our heads as we pray. O loving God and Father who art in heaven, we are so thankful that you are our God, because as our God you know the end from the beginning. As our God you are able to understand our feelings, you are able to understand our emotions, and you are able to send comfort and give comfort to us in times like these when we mourn the loss of a loved one. And so even now, Father in heaven, we thank you for the provision of comfort that you have made for this family, so that as they have gone through this experience, and even now as they come to this final part of this experience, that they will feel your hand of comfort in their lives, that you will give them the strength that they will need to be able to exist and continue even without the loved one. We thank you, Father in heaven, for what you will continue to do for them, what you will continue to be for them. And we pray, Father in heaven, that even through this experience, that they will see your guiding hand and that they will see your comforting hand. So we thank you again for your comfort. We thank you again for your assurance that death is not the final chapter in this life, but that there is a better life to come. So we give you thanks, and we give you praise, and we give you thanks for everything. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen.
The scripture reading for today is coming from Matthew chapter 11, verse 28 through 30. Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and ye shall find rest unto your soul. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light.
Proverbs 18:24 states, a friend is one who has a bond of mutual affection. It says some friends play at friendship, but a true friend sticks closer than one's nearest kin. Nellie, Aunt Nell, as we all call her, I met Aunt Nell some 60 years ago when we were students at the Unique High School. And from there, we had a bond which served us until her death. In those days, we did not have a telephone. So at the end of term, especially in summer, we would plan our picnics, who to bring what, and where it would be. The only thing we had to rely on is the fact that you turn up, because we had no other means of finding out whether you're coming or not. We had such a bond that we did not have to correspond with each other. We both began as teachers, but I realized that calling was not for me, so I dropped out by the way, but she continued. When she immigrated to Cayman Islands, very seldom we would correspond with one another by mail. But I know that when it comes to the summer holiday, if she didn't go to see Aunt Merle, her sister in England, I would get a call, I'm coming in tonight, pick me up at the airport. I would pick her up, and she would go to my house, not even to her mother's. And we would sit and we would start from the beginning to the end, all the things we wanted to tell one another, that would be the whole conversation. I remember one night, and I'm always telling her about it, while we were talking, I heard the 5 o'clock bus. And I said to her, Aunt Nell, don't stop talking now, keep talking, because I have to go work in the morning. And she would say to me when she was leaving, if you don't hear a plane crash, you know that I'm okay. And that would be until we meet again. Aunt Nell was my friend. She was like a sister to me. And if I go to when she immigrated to New York, and I go to New York and she was going to church a Saturday morning, and I didn't have clothes, I would look into her wardrobe and I would find a dress to wear to church. And if she's in Barbados and I'm going to church and she didn't have clothes, she would look into my wardrobe and she would find a dress to wear to church. She was a person who loved unconditionally. She was gracious and kind. I don't remember ever hearing Aunt Nell in any scuffle or with anybody. She was such a gentle person. And she always reminded me of her mother, because Godmother was the same way, very soft-spoken. But Aunt Nell would give her last. I always tried to avoid telling her or letting her hear that I wanted something. Because if she heard that I wanted something, it was going to be there. I remember the last time when my husband was ill and I was in New York, and she came to visit me, and apparently I wasn't home. And when I got back to the house, there was an envelope, and in it was some money. And she said, I know that you're up here, and I know that you might be short of money. And she brought some money and leave it for me. Aunt Nell loved family. Her family was all in all to her. And she was a person who, even if you weren't family and you wanted something, you could always get it from Aunt Nell. Aunt Nell was a person who was so kind that sometimes I thought that people took her kindness for granted. But that was her nature. And so in all our lives, we have been together. We have been with each other. We have stood beside each other. And so I know that although she's gone, she would not be forgotten. And I would read this poem for you. Don't think that she has gone away. Her journey's just begun. This earth is only one. Just think of her as resting from the sorrows and the tears in a place of warmth and comfort where there are no days or years. Think how she must be wishing that we could know today how nothing but our sadness can really pass away. And think of her as flying in the hearts of those she touched. For nothing love is ever lost, and she has loved so much. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. I know it is not a good time for me to be standing before you, because it's not easy for a brother to bury a sister who is younger than him. And the feeling that I have about her, I cannot express it to you now because it takes too much time. And since Annelda have laid it out so clearly, she leaves me nothing to say. But I can tell you, as a big brother growing up with a little sister, always shielding her out of trouble when she's a little girl, and she always running to me when she's gonna get spanked. So I am telling you guys, I am happy to see that you all here. For all who have met her or dealt with her, know her kindness and her heart, because she was so loving and so gentle. And I've never in my lifetime, this might be hard to believe, ever heard she speak any bad language. She was that gentle and that kind. And I'm here just to tell all of you that we all must celebrate her life and always remember the things that she did, all that she played in our lives, and not to be thinking about her death, but thinking about her life, all that she had done. Because every one of you here, I'm sure she touched your lives in some way, or one of your friends, because she was that kind and so open. And for the family, I will remind you of one thing my mother told me when I was a little boy. Always learn to lose the things you love in order to survive. We will survive and ask for her family. We will survive for her daughter, her grandson, her husband, and her niece and nephews and everyone. So let us feel that we have seen the time when we all can remember her together, and she will always in our heart, and always remember Nelly for who she was and what she did. Thank you.
Thank you. We will now have a musical tribute by Amanda Fields.
Why should I feel discouraged? Why should the shadows come? Why should my heart be lonely and long for heaven and home? When Jesus is my portion, my constant friend is he. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. Let not your heart be troubled. His tender word I hear, and resting on his goodness, I lose my doubts and fears. Though by the path he leadeth, but one step I may see, his eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. I sing because I'm happy. I sing because I'm free. For his eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. Whenever I am tempted, whenever clouds arise, when song gives place to sighing, when hope within me dies, I draw the closer to him. From care he sets me free. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. I sing because I'm happy. I sing because I'm free, for his eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. I sing because I'm happy. I sing because I'm free, for his eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. For his eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me.
Good afternoon. Annelda Ureta Gooding was born September 16, 1950 to Eric Gooding and Kate Eva Gooding on the island of Barbados. She had an older sister named Merle and an older brother named Ollington. She also had another brother, Godfrey, who passed in childhood. Annelda would get severe bouts of bronchitis as a child. And as I mentioned, brother Godfrey was lost to polio. So when she would become sick, her parents sent her to live with two sisters who were nurses at the hospital. One sister was the matron at the hospital. These sisters were quite wealthy and exposed Annelda to a very affluent lifestyle, which she carried into adulthood. Annelda went to school at the Unique School in Christ Church, Barbados, where she met many lifelong friends, namely Angela Clark. She later graduated from Erdiston Teachers Training College at the age of 17 and began teaching primary school. She later moved to the Cayman Islands and worked there as an expatriate teacher. During her time in the Cayman Islands, she never forgot her family back home. So she continued to support her mother and her three nieces, Jennifer, Verndell, and Clarita. At one point, her niece Jennifer lived with her in the Cayman Islands. It was also during this time in the Cayman Islands that she became a worldwide traveler. She traveled to many places in Europe and the Caribbean. At times, she was the only black person in the entire tour group, but she did not let that distract her from enjoying her vacations. She decided to move from the Cayman Islands to America to attend university. She attended Pratt University, where she graduated with her Bachelor's of Science in Nutrition. After graduation, she worked as a nutritionist at Memorial Sloan Kettering Cancer Center in New York City in pediatric oncology. She was known for personally meeting with the children battling childhood cancers and making them individualized foods that they would like while they were receiving chemotherapy. After graduating from Pratt University, she married Fitz Albert Payne, who's also from Barbados. She then gave birth to her daughter, Erica Gooding Payne, who is named after her Aunt Nell's dad, Eric Gooding. Aunt Nell, as she is affectionately known, was a devoted mother and made it a point to only work part-time so that she could dedicate the majority of her time to raising her daughter, Erica, and myself, Annette. She was the driving force in their education, such that her daughter Erica graduated with a double degree in sociology and health sciences, and her niece Annette graduated as a medical doctor. When her daughter Erica was in elementary school, Annelda went back to university to further her studies. She attended the prestigious New York University and graduated with a master's degree in nutrition and dietetics and also certification as a registered dietitian. Later, she also achieved certification in childhood obesity and also became a certified diabetes educator. She worked for Meals on Wheels, where she provided nutritional counseling to the elderly and shut-ins in Queens, New York. She would talk fondly of the elderly patients she interacted with and who would be so happy to see her. She worked as a dietitian for Coney Island Hospital and also New Jersey Medical Center. She later retired from Kings County Hospital, where she was the assistant director of their nutrition program. Aunt Nell had a quiet personality, but she was a tremendous woman. She cherished education and made it a point to educate herself and the family around her. She loved cooking and would often make elaborate gourmet meals for her family. She was an avid reader and would spend most of her time reading instead of watching television. She read many books, but the book she read the most was the Bible. She was an authority on the Bible and would often joke about when she was a child and had to go to the Seventh-day Adventist Church on Saturday and the Methodist Church on Sunday. She put her faith into action throughout her life. She was a loving wife of 36 years and a devoted mother to her child and multiple nieces. She was a caring and empathetic clinician. But most of all, she was a genuinely loving person, and we are all blessed to have had her in our life. Sadly, Aunt Nell developed Alzheimer's disease, which caused her steady decline in later life. She died on May 8, 2020, at the age of 69. She is survived by her husband, Fitz Albert Payne, her brother, Arlington Roach, daughter Erica Gooding-Payne, grandson Langston Grenade, myself, Annette Cito, my older sisters Jennifer, Verndell, Clarita, my younger sister Letitia, and various other nieces and nephews of the UK and also here in Barbados. Thank you for taking the time to be here with us and celebrating her life. I appreciate it. Thank you.
I'm sure, based on what we've heard in the eulogy, what we've heard through the tributes, that we can all say amen. We truly want to give God thanks for her life, her contribution to society, and to the lives of others. And it takes me, when I think about it, it takes me back to Moses. He has just come out of the 40 years of wandering, and he was reflecting on the journey through the wilderness. He too was about to, was given the understanding by God that he will not be able to enter into the promised land just yet, and that he too will see death. And as he reflected on the journey, as he reflected on God's goodness during the journey, he wrote a psalm, or what we call a meditative prayer, which is found in Psalm 90. And he begins by saying, "Lord, thou hast been our dwelling place in all generations." Here was this man who would have seen those who would have come out of Egypt and their generations to follow, some of them fallen by the wayside through death. And yet, just only those who were 20 years old and younger, ready to go into the promised land. And he recognized that in all of that journey, God was there. There was a time then when there was no water, but God was there. There was a time when they were attacked by snakes and God was there. There was a time when outside got hot and God came over as a cloud in the day and a pillar of fire in the night. And I'm sure that Annelda too, as she went through her life and as she reflected, she too would have seen through the sands of her life, she would have seen God's hand directing and guiding her. Oh yeah, she would have traveled many places, we understood. She was traveling. I can't call you a traveling man, God, call you a traveling miss. But in it, she was still faithful to her God. She was still faithful to what she believed. She was still made sure that she worshiped him on Sabbath days. She made sure that she lived according to the principles that he would have established in his word. She saw God in her life. And in seeing God in her life, she understood the eternity of God and the attributes of God. Him, he is being all powerful. He is all knowing. He is compassionate. He is merciful. He is love. Moses says, before the mountains were brought forth, God, you were there. And even before the earth was formed, from everlasting to everlasting, you are God. Moses, in writing this prayer, was not just looking at the eternity of God and the attributes of God, but he brought it in line and compared it to the fragility of man. God, infinite, and man, finite. God, immortal, and man, mortal. God, one who will live forever, man, who will see death. The fragility of life, the brevity of man's life. He says, in the morning it flourisheth, and in the evening, he says, in the morning it flourishes and groweth up, and in the evening it is cut down and withereth. Life. And Annelda, in her experience as a nutritionist and with those who she wanted to make sure they got the best nutrition because of the experiences that they would have encountered being patients of cancer, she would have understood the brevity of life. Some people say, you're here today, and you're gone tomorrow. I say, you're here today, and you're gone today. That's how brief life is. That's how brief life is. He says, for we are consumed by thy anger and by thy wrath are we troubled, for all our days are passed away in thy wrath. We spend our years as a tale that is told. Life. What is life? Moses says, it is a tale that is told. A tale has a beginning, and it also has an end. I'm not too sure if you've ever seen a book that doesn't have an end. I think all of the books that I know, even you remember when you used to read those books, and they blighted once upon a time long, long far away, and they live happily ever after. And so Moses wanted to help his readers to understand that even though you may be young and even though you may have life now, it is so brief. It is so brief. It says the days of our years are 70 years and 10. I remember reading the Bible and men lived up to 930 years as Adam. Yeah,
Noah, who actually fled, lived up to 600 and something. But here's Moses now coming out, and he says, hey, all you have is 70. I read something just the other day when people believe that midlife is 50 years old. Midlife is really 35. You only get midlife at 50 if you live to be 100. And so young people believe that at 30 and 35 that they're still young, you're really at midlife. When we understand that we only have 70 years and we start to count, I remember when I was a young boy. That was not too long ago. You know, you will see older folk and you'll go like, boy, them old, yeah. You know, you see some people 40 years old and 30-something years. I mean, it's 14 years. You go like, they're old. Hey, I passed 30-something. I passed 40-something. And the brevity of life comes when you begin to see those who went to school with you having occasions like these. And you realize, boy, my time coming around. And Moses says to his readers, because you understand who God is and because you understand who you are and the brevity of life, he says to God, God, because of who you are, teach us to number our days. Teach us and help us to understand whatever modes and means to appreciate the shortness and brevity of life. You know something? When you know that you don't have time is when things begin to get urgent. Am I right? When you got time, you don't really worry about it. Just go easy. But as you see yourself advancing in years, you begin to start thinking about a next egg and will and all of these things that deal with the ending of life. Teach us to number our days. Because Moses wanted his readers to understand that the numbering of your days is not so that you can enjoy the rest of your life by yourselves and for yourselves, but the numbering of your days will help you to understand who God is and what he can do in your life, what he can do for your life. You see, when we understand that it's only God that knows the beginning from the end, and that everything that happens passes before God's face before it happens. So God saw this moment. Albert, God saw this moment. God knew what you would be experiencing right now. And God in his wisdom, God in his mercy, God in his grace has already provided what you need and what Annette needs and what Erica needs and what all of us need to get through this experience. Because he is God. And it's only when we recognize the greatness and the awesomeness of God, and when we see ourselves compared to God, that we then believe that, hey, the only way that we're going to get through this is by putting our hands in the one who is greater than us. Not the almighty dollar. Because that fades away. I was talking to somebody this morning, and I asked the person, how are you doing? The person said, I want some money. I said, everybody wants money. Elon Musk, who is probably one of the richest men in the world, he not home lying, don't sleep in. He looking how to make money. Bill Gates, he not lying, don't home sleep. He said, well, I have made enough, so let me just rest myself. He is looking to make more money. So everybody wants money. So the more you get, the more you want. And so the only person that can really help us in this life is the one who has been our dwelling place through all generations. Is the one who has been there from the beginning of time. And as we meditate on the brevity of life, we may be wise, in employing the time that God has allotted to us. Moments like these, experiences like these, like this one, is not just supposed to be a time for us to come and say, okay, I'm sorry, but it's also a time for us to reflect on our own lives. What have I done with my life that I can say God will be pleased with the life that he has allotted to me, with the time that he has allotted to me? Moses wants us to understand that the best way to live our life, the best way to number our days, is to rely and trust in the goodness of God and give our lives into his hands. When we vote for politicians who we best believe will forward the interests of the country economically and socially, yeah? So that's where we're going to put down our X and make sure that we put our X next to the person who we believe. We are often trusting ourselves and trusting our lives into the hands of things and the hands of people. Annette, you came here on an airplane. You know the guy who drove it? You don't know him, right? I don't know him either. And I may be able to tell you a few things about him, but I don't know him either. But you trusted him. And he trusted the instrument panel that he was watching. He trusted the persons who were at the controller, who when they passed them from one controller to the next controller, he trusted that when they said to him, turn 300 degrees to the west, to the west, and go to 3,000 or 5,000 feet, he did as they told, as they said, because why? He trusted them. But they're mere human beings. Another trusted God. If we were in church, you would have to say amen for that one. Well, we're not in church, but you can still say amen for that one. Another trusted God. Even when we visited her, she took us to church. We went to church with myself and my wife. When we visited, we went to church with her. And her trust in God is seen through how she related to other people. I think I heard somebody say it's unconditional love. I think somebody here said that. I think I heard somebody say that she was kind. She wasn't just kind because she was kind. She was kind because she trusted God. She was loving because she trusted God. She sacrificed and she did what she did for those children that came under her care because she trusted God. Moses truly understood that life on this earth will end in death. Annelda understood that as well. She probably would have seen it many times in her work. But Moses also understood that death is not the final chapter. Life does not have to be, at death, life does not have to be a closed book. But there can be a little footnote that says, to be continued. And how your story will continue will depend on the decision that you have made with the time that God has allotted to you. If you're going to write to be continued, it will have to be determined by how much you trusted and you depended on God and you had that relationship with God. So Moses understood that all of us can live with the hope of resurrection and life forevermore. And that's why he says, teach us to number our days. Teach us to number our days that we may apply our hearts unto wisdom. I don't know about you, but I think the wisest decision a person can ever make is to make sure that they're able to have eternal life. I think that's the wisest decision a person can ever make, to ensure that you have eternal life. And Moses understood that the only way that you can have eternal life, the only way that you can put to be continued and know that the next chapter in your book will open up with peace and joy and life forevermore, is if you give your life to God. So the important question is, what will your story say? John chapter 5, verse 28 and verse 29. John chapter 5, verse 28 and verse 29 tells us that there will be a resurrection. There will be a resurrection. He says, marvel not at this. This is Jesus speaking. For the hour is coming in the which all that are in the graves shall hear his voice and shall come forth. They that have done good unto the resurrection of life, and they that have done evil unto the resurrection of damnation. So some people's book will say to be continued, but the next chapter may be damnation. And some people's book will say to be continued, and the next chapter will be everlasting life. So every single man, every single woman, every single boy and girl, we all have the same opportunity and the same choice to choose whether we're going to have everlasting life or damnation. I think Annelda made her decision for an everlasting life. And she showed it in her commitment to the cause of God and to her worship of her God and doing what God would have wanted her to do. And I often say at services like these that she has made her decision, but now it's up to us to make our decision. Because if she has made a decision for everlasting life and our decision is tending to damnation, then we may never see her again. But if our decision is tending to everlasting life, then we have the assurance that we will see her again. The Bible tells us, Jesus says, I will come again. He says, and I will, so that where I am, there ye may be also. He has some place prepared for us. He says, my Father has many houses. He says, if it wasn't so, I would have done tell you. He says, and I'm going to the house to prepare a place for you, prepare a place for you specially. And he says, when I've done prepare that, I'm going to come again. And he says, when I come, John chapter 5, some will rise to everlasting life and some will rise to eternal damnation. My encouragement this evening to all of us is to number our days so that it leads to everlasting life. Apply our hearts to wisdom, wisdom that will lead to everlasting life. Oh, that time is going to be so sweet. And John says that he saw a new heaven and a new earth. He says, for the former things are passed away. He says, and there was no more sorrow, no more death, no more pain. I like that. I just got some pain in my knees. When it was 14, 16 years old, I didn't think about the pain in the knees, man. But now I got pain in my knees. But there's a day coming when there'll be no more pain. There'll be no more need for undertakers. No more need for nobody to stream your funeral. I want to be there. Annelda has already made her decision. I'm standing saying, I'm making my decision to be there. And every single one of us here, and every single one of us in internet land,
We all have to make our decision. Why? Teach us to number our days. So that if perchance you don't make 70, you still would have made the right decision. Or perchance you do make 70, you still would have made the right decision. And perchance you go past 70 and get 40 years, you still would have made the right decision. So teach us to number our days and apply our hearts on to wisdom. O Lord, who has been our dwelling place in all generations. Let us pray. Our Father and our God who art in heaven, we give you thanks for the life of your daughter. We thank you for the impact that she would have made upon all those who she would have come in connection with. And that all of them could say that she was a loving person, that she was a kind person, that she was a person who looked after the needs of others first. All of them could say that she was a loving wife of 36, a wonderful mother, an aunt. But we know that all of this only happened because of her relationship with you. But it also helps us to understand, Father, that we too may come to that point in our lives where life ceases. We no longer exist. And we may not be able to hear, but we don't need to hear, because our lives would have reflected what we will hear. But we hear the same thing, that we were loving and kind and trusted God. Would we hear that we have made a decision for everlasting life? Because people can say all of the nice things, Father, they can say all of the nice things about us, but if we have not made that decision for everlasting life, then all that we have done in life counts for naught. And so help us to be to depend on you. Help us to be faithful to you. Help us to trust you. Help us to give our lives over into your hands, knowing that you have only our best interests at heart. So we thank you for the example. We thank you for her life and for the example that she has left for us to follow. And may we be able to live a life that is pleasing in your sight, a life that would have showed to everyone we come in contact with that we are applying our hearts to wisdom. We are about now to go to the place where we will lay the remains to rest. We believe, Father in heaven, that you will have already marked that spot, so that when the time shall come and Jesus shall burst the azure sky and the trumpet of the Lord shall sound and then her name is called, that wherever she may be, she will come back into the form that you will want her to be, which is human form. And she will go to live with you forevermore. We thank you for the assurance of resurrection power. And may we all have that experience in our lives as well. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Let us stand and sing the wondrous love of Jesus. sing his mercy and his grace in the mansions bright and blessed. He prepared for us a place where we all get to heaven. Sing the wondrous love of Jesus, sing his mercy and his grace. In the mansions bright and blessed, he prepared for us a place. Oh, when we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we will sing and shout the victory. While we walk the pilgrim's pathway, clouds will overspread the sky. But when traveling days are over, not a shadow, not a sigh. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we will sing and shout the Let us then be true and faithful, trusting, serving every day. Just one glimpse of him in glory will the toils of life repay. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we will sing and shout the victory. Onward to the prize before us, soon his beauty will behold. Soon the pearly gates will open, we shall tread the streets of gold. Oh, when we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. At this moment, we will move over to the space, the place where we would lay the remains to rest. All right, well, this is not going to take that long. I guess the guy who is... Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we once again give you thanks for the opportunity when we can come and celebrate the life of a loved one. And even now as we go through this experience of laying the remains to rest, we ask your spirit to continue to be a source of comfort for the family, even as they go through this experience. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. For as much as God in his goodness and his infinite love and wisdom has permitted our dear sister Annelda Gooding-Payne to fall asleep in Christ, we do tenderly commit her body to the ground in the sure and certain hope of a joyful resurrection when our Lord shall return in glory. Then this body of humiliation shall be changed and made like unto his glorious body, according to the mighty working whereby he is able even to subdue all things to himself. Okay, go ahead. We'll sing At the Cross.
Sovereign die, would he devote that sacred life? Let us pray. Father and God in heaven, we have laid your daughter to rest. We believe that you will mark this spot so that when Christ comes again, and that he will call her name and she will resurrect it to go home with him. Continue to comfort the family. Continue to be with them in a special way. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. On behalf of the family, I want to thank all who would have been here this afternoon to share in this celebration of the life of Aunt Nell. And we want to encourage you to continue to keep the family in your prayers. Continue to give them words of encouragement even as they continue to go through this experience. There is a reception at the home of Fitz, of Albert. I think you know where that is, in Folbear. Yeah, in Folbear. So there's a reception afterwards, so you can join the family as they're for this reception and continue to reflect on the life of Aunt Nell. God bless you and get where you're going safely.